overall, the, you know, this contribution, the idea that the coming together of the financial inclusion and so, you know, the kind of social policy elements, asset-based welfare, with the kind of general critique of the kind of persistent financialization of everyday life and the critique of that, bringing these two together, I think, is a really unique contribution. Because the thing that it really made me think about, you know, first of all, was this idea within this kind of critique of the finance, you know, kind of financialization of everyday life and what does that really mean, is this idea that kind of finance is a social technology, the kind of social technology that's embedded within political and economic structures. Because I think for myself, my own critique of the financial inclusion literature, which is not extensive, is only that so much is out of the control of the people that are really dedicated to, you know, financial capability, improving, you know, welfare provision, you know, actually eliminating harm and the real pressure and material damage that indebtedness does to people. You know, they genuinely are trying to give people tools to engage it. But my perspective is always that so much is out of their control, because in the end, it's about what the central bank sets the interest rate as and the regulatory environment that allows, you know, this kind of hierarchy of terms of credit in which that creates these big subsections, you know, ultimately in society that pay, again, many hundreds of percent interest on £50. But if you're able to borrow £50 million, you'll get it at a, you know, maybe negative real interest rates. You know, in fact, you'll get money out of the deal if you calculate it correctly. You know, especially the work of the Financial Inclusion Commission, which is, you know, really quite excellent in so many regards, is a way that we kind of come back in a strange way to, you know, via the poverty premium, you know, quite almost Dickensian kind of themed, you know, discussions about the kind of harm that debt can do in society and why we need to mobilize, you know, a more thoughtful and strategic approach to tackling, you know, the wider problems that you know, having such widespread access to finance can cause. So I think, you know, from my point of view, you know, really what I'm going to take away from this book on many levels is the idea of, again, this sort of applied thinking about the financialization of everyday life and how can we engage in the kind of policy debate. If when you follow the logic of the book, you start with this idea that this friction between or tensions between these understandings of financialization and everyday life is that on the one hand, it's sort of eroding the welfare state. And on the other hand, you know, we need to be able to kind of give people the tools and the understanding of how to navigate this financialized world and the tensions between them. So, and that is to, you know, how can we move forward rather than finance, private finance and public provision as being separate. You know, I believe 2008 was a moment of rupture. You know, I know everybody's all still COVID right now and that's the latest flavor, but we had a crisis I guess 13 years ago now, it seems like 20, but you know, that we're still not getting over, you know, it's still not overcome. And once we began, you know, wholesale coordinated international monetization, you know, of national debt and using QE, once we made that decision, there was no break, there was no separation between public and private finance. So, you know, that sailed on the macroeconomic level, that ship has sailed. It just means, how do we provide public provision of credit? If the government subsidizes private credit in this way, how can it be used for public provision? And I think that means that people shouldn't be suffering under the weight of high interest rates in the era of historically low interest rates. If we've never had interest rates so low for such a long period, I think it's time to make this kind of claim to democratizing finance in a more realistic way, which says give people access to low interest rates. But also crucially as well, to think about the regulatory legal structures, you know, which I think the book does really well as well, to think about, the debt advisors. Why is debt advice a charity? Why are they providing this on a charitable basis? You know, the great work that was done by the group at the LSE, Deborah James, sorry, it didn't come to me, on debt advice and the debt advisors. You know, the multiple registers of expertise that you need to give free debt advice, from the welfare system to the financial regulation system to the, you know, to the service agreements, to utility bills, to private rent, to housing associations. I mean, these, you know, I compare them to the type of experts that are on a monetary policy committee. And I'm telling you, being a debt advisor requires many, many more types of knowledge and technical understanding. You know, why is this being given sort of, you know, in a charitable frame? And why don't we think about welfare provision? You know, if this is the reality that we need to borrow to have housing, we need to borrow to get a degree, we need to borrow to get a car, we need to borrow to live. You know, why aren't we providing, you know, a more comprehensive set of tools? You know, I think that's the more benign question. And then the other is, why do we have to borrow to live?